This, of course, is Lega Gott, which is in front of our home at White River, and these shots were taken nearly 50 years ago, and that's halfway to the Kruger National Park, and it represents a lion lying down and looking towards the right. Now here's a home with Michael, who's about 8 there, and this is, of course, his Athle, my first wife, who died shortly after we came to the States. And these are the two Weimaraners that she was wanted to breed from. She was fascinated with Weimaraners and came to Germany with me in order to select a Weimaraner from Westphalia, from the Weimaraner Club. That, of course, is David there, and there is about 3 or 4 years old. The dog on the right is Heidrich von Sieg, the one we brought from Germany. And the other one is on the left is Trudy, and she, of course, was a South African dog. She was a beautiful animal. And this was our Rhodesian Ridgeback, and we were taking her for a walk, and she was a big cobra struck at her, and it was in winter when they're actually in hibernation, but in the summer, in the sun in the morning, they often come out about 10 feet from their hole. And we decided to dig that snake out, and we got one of our fellows in the factory who knew about snakes come and do it for us. Now these are shots of the two Weimaraners, and of course they had to be trained as gun dogs if you were a member of the German Weimaraner Club, which Mary was. Now this is the front of our home, and these were a lot of the aloes. Mainly they were hybrid aloes from different areas that Athle and her friend Helen Bird had collected. We have some here in the USA, but unfortunately we can't get them to flower. We have not yet discovered why. This is a typical hybrid that Athalie, actually she brought it to Drum Rock Hotel from our home in White River when we bought the hotel. And that was about 6 years later. This is looking down over our fence. Of course, now it's about 10 feet high and you can't actually see the house from the road. A woman attorney bought it from us before we left White River, and we found we had to move to the hotel in order to control the staff. These were my first attempts at micro photography with a 16mm Peyer Berlix movie camera. What you're seeing here, of course, is bees attempting to eat the nectar from the aloes. Thank you. You see, they actually put the nectar around their legs before they fly off from the aloes. Now, we don't have hummingbirds in South Africa, but they have sunbirds, and they're a little bit larger than the hummingbirds you have over here. And these are some shots taken around our home of sunbirds attempting to take the nectar from the aloes. And this one is singing, but unfortunately, I don't have any recordings of sunbirds singing. And of course, in bird life, the females generally have less color than the male. And those were females you saw with no color on their chests. And this is a ring plover that selected the middle of our lawn in front of the house to build its nest on the ground. And of course, they mainly rely upon camouflage in order to, the eggs match the ground so much that predators can hardly see them. And of course, they also pretend to be injured and would guide the dogs away from the nest, and you'll see that shortly. As far as I remember, we had gone down to our cottage at Plettenberg Bay, which is about 1,400 miles from White River in the Cape. And that's when she selected that place to build her nest, and probably wouldn't have done so if she realized we had these two very excitable young dogs. Thank you. They were successful, actually, in keeping the dogs away from the nest. They'd draw them, the dogs towards the fence of the outer fence of the house. This was Trudy, the female dog, or Bitcher, I guess you call her. She was a beautiful animal. Now, at this time, we were preparing the factory. We were preparing the factory, and one of the first people that I met down at Metaffin, where we built our plant, was Johnny Johnson, who was in charge of Native Affairs. And he told me that they had a fellow called Bamba Nyoka, an African, who would remove poisonous snakes from people's homes behind their fridges or in the roof. Now this particular snake you're seeing now is a bird-eating, an egg-eating snake. But it's not poisonous, but it when it rubs its coils as it is doing there without actually moving from where it is, makes a hissing noise and that keeps the birds away. And here we see Atherley catching one of the tiny ring plovers after it was born. And like many other wild animals or wild birds, when you put it down, it won't move because most predators rely upon movement, especially snakes. And if you stay absolutely still, they may not even touch you. Thank you. And here we see one of our supervisors from the plant, Kuipers, who used to make a habit of collecting poisonous snakes, helping us dig out this cobra that had struck at Porpi about 10 days before. He said that snakes leave their hibernation and go and warm themselves up, even in the winter when it's cold. And if you happen to be between their hole and when they're lying, you're in danger. And that's probably why this gentleman struck at Porpi. We had this snake for about a week or so before we let it go. And you will see some shots of it here, raising its hood and being ready to strike. Of course, that's Matthew, who was our houseboy at our plant. Whatever we did, I should say our home, not our plant. Whatever he did, he always had to be involved, and he got himself involved in this one, and he realized it was a little bit over his head. I think the correct name for this particular cobra was an Egyptian cobra, which has the yellow bands on the inside of the hood. Now, in a moment, you're going to see the first shots I ever took of Bamba and Yorker. I was at the plant, and somebody said, there's an African outside with a bag over his shoulder, and he wants to see you. And when I went out there, he had two black mambas in the bag, two 10-foot-long black mambas, one of those world's most poisonous snakes. So we arranged for him to take them out of the bag, where we had our rain gauge and other equipment outside the plant. Here you see him here. An amazing thing is that this snake will not attempt to bite him, even when he gets in its way when they try to escape. Notice when he's doing this that he doesn't hold the snake close to its neck. Could easily strike him, but for some reason it doesn't. And so I must say goodbye, because this is all we have left of this film.